gastrointestinal symptoms that we commonly encounter. Madam will be discussing about constipation and bowel obstruction mainly. As Madam was mentioning during the last session, that there are so many symptoms, but we are just, today we'll be discussing only about constipation and bowel obstruction. Already we had an introduction about Dr. Lulu Matthews, so we'll straight away get into the session. Ma'am?
Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am.
The screen is visible?
Yes, we can see.
Is the screen visible?
Yes, yes, yes.
Okay. Yeah, yeah. 2 days back, we had a class on the nausea and vomiting. Now we go to the other end, namely constipation. Okay. So, what is constipation? I'm sure you all know what constipation is. Actually speaking, constipation is a real, especially in the elderly. And moreover, if they happen to be a palliative, it's really a serious problem. Ultimately, just as pain, because pain is what the patient.
Doctor, we have lost Lulu Matthew.
Patient says, because one person may be in the habit of today, and if unable to move like that, he will have constipation. And you might say, why? You're daily passing, then why?
But Madam, your voice is slightly breaking.
His habit is that he may be passing, moving his bowel 2 times a day. Now, sometimes he may be passing once in 2 days. So you have to ask him what his normal pattern is. And then only you will understand what he says by telling, I'm distressed, I'm constipated. Okay. So constipation is ultimately a difficult or painful defecation. And it is associated with infrequent passage of bowel evacuation. It's quite not regular. It's irregular. And the patient may also be passing hard fecal matter. Ultimately, as I told you, how different it is from their normal. That's what is most important. And 50% of palliative care patients are constipated when they come to us. So you should be having a clear-cut idea what constipation is, how to manage it. Okay, so constipation can lead to feeling of incomplete evacuation. He feels, I have to pass in, I have to move my bowel again, and bloated feeling. Because he is not having the regular bowel movement, he has a bloated feeling. And sometimes, you know, he even starts getting nausea, vomiting, abdominal cramps and pain. Okay, and then he can even have overflow diarrhea. I'll come to it. And you know, because the rectum and the urinary bladder are close by, if hard fecal matter gets collected in the rectum, naturally it can lead on to urinary retention also. So apart from, because of constipation, the patient can have a lot of problems. The causes can be several. See, when you are in palliative care, you should be worried about what are the drugs the patient is on, because antidepressants, anticholinergics, antiepileptics, antiemetics, antacids, they all can lead on to constipation. So the history taking should be really good. And again, suppose the patient is dehydrated, or if he has hypercalcemia, or hypokalemia, or even uremia, again, he will be constipated. Or diet, he may not be taking in anything, and he may not be taking sufficient water, and he may not have included fiber-rich diet, okay, food. And again, the environment. Suppose when he comes to the hospital or the inpatient setting, you know, it's a new place, it's a new toilet facility. Some people, especially the elderly, they want to move the bowel in their own house, in their own toilet. So when it is a new place, they cannot move their bowel. And again, patients may be admitted and they might be lying on the cot. And you think you cannot, the patient cannot walk up to the toilet. So you say, okay, give him a commode or a commode chair. That means there is no privacy. So again, he is unable to move his bowel. Or he could be having neurological conditions like malignant spinal cord compression, sacral nerve infiltration, all what lead to problem with bowel evacuation. Sometimes, you know, he may be having pelvic tumors pressing on his rectum or radiation-induced fibrosis or painful anorectal conditions or sometimes even intraluminal tumors or obstruction. Then other conditions are if he is very much depressed, if he is very weak, always lying down, bedridden, not moving around, inactive, all these can lead on to constipation. So most important is finding out what is normal for the patient. How frequently has he been passing the stool? What is the amount he is passing? What is the consistency? Is it bloodstained or not? And again, I tell you, don't just ask, when was your last bowel movement? The question should be, when was the last satisfactory bowel movement? That is the most important. Only if the patient says he has satisfactorily moved his bowel, then only you should be quiet. Otherwise, you know, you should be worried that he is having problem. Is the patient having an abdominal discomfort, cramps, nausea, vomiting, excessive gas, or rectal fullness, rectal discomfort? All these are points which should be elicited in the history. Again, some people, you know, they will be regularly taking some laxatives, especially the elderly. And when they have some other problem, naturally the constipation becomes even more. Again, as I told you, what medications are the patient on? Is constipation a recent change or has he been chronically constipated? What is his diet? These are some of the questions you should ask. And when to try to manage constipation, always correct the correctable. Okay, if he is dehydrated, corrected. If he is hypokalemic, corrected. Okay, if he is on any drugs which are causing constipation, try to substitute it if possible. Judicious use of laxatives. You should be using laxatives in a proper manner. And again, I told you, if the patient is very feeble, tired, he will have constipation. So you should be improving his general condition. And other symptoms should be controlled. Okay, he may be having cough for which he is taking antitussives. Antitussives are also causing constipation. So you should be bothered about the other symptoms also. Encourage the patient to be active and also to take fiber-rich diet. Okay. So what are the non-pharmacological measures? See that he has access to a nearby toilet and he can walk to the toilet if he wants that. Again, privacy. If he is unable to walk to a toilet, at least when he is moving his bowel, you should place a screen around his bed. Okay, and let him be moving his bowel in a private setting. If people are around, he may not feel like moving his bowel. And again, some people want the squatting position. They are used to that at home. And in the hospitals, it may be the European type of closet. So what can you do? You can give him a bedpan and ask him to sit on the bed with the feet under the knees and to blow gently. At the same time, bending forward, arms resting on the thighs. Okay, somewhat like squatting. And always encourage a balanced diet with plenty of water. And again, when you talk to the carers, you know, what they will be telling, oh, he's not eating anything. How will he pass motion? If you again ask history, the patient will tell, I have not had a satisfactory bowel movement for the past 10 days, 20 days. But the carer will be telling you, see, he is not eating anything. That is why he is not moving the bowel. So you have to break this discrepancy and talk properly to the patient. Again, other people will say, the patient is having diarrhea. And doctor, you are asking whether he is constipated. In fact, he is passing loose motion. So I'll come to it later on. See, a large bowel transit, that is once the food reaches a large bowel, it takes about 3 to 4 days, even in normal people. And what does stool contain? Mainly shed epithelium, and the major bulk is the byproduct of bacterial action. So even if the patient has not taken any food for 1 or 2 days, still he will be having fecal matter, which he has to get out. Okay, and again, so the first thing is a proper rectal examination. These are the principles: proper use of the right laxatives, proper use of suppositories. Enemas could be glycerin enema, warm saline enema, plain water enema, soap water enema, anything can be given. And digital evacuation. You do a per rectal examination and per rectal evacuation. You remove all the hard fecal matter which is there. And you know, laxative, not all laxatives are the same. See, certain laxatives like docusate and liquid paraffin, it softens the stool. So if a patient is very tired, he has no strength to push, so a softener will help. In that, it will make the stool very soft. Then there are stimulant laxatives. You have learned about morphine. You know, morphine, whenever a patient is on morphine, he will become constipated because the whole GIT becomes very sluggish, very, very sluggish. So the ideal laxative to be given along with morphine is a stimulant laxative like Senna or Bisacodyl, because this will stimulate the GIT, stimulate peristalsis. So that, you know, morphine has made the GIT very sluggish. When he gives rectal stimulant laxatives, stimulate peristalsis, so the patient starts moving his bowel. Then there are some bulk forming, Isabgol. So Isabgol is such a costly thing, you know, because it is costly, so many people think it is good. But don't use it in palliative care patients at all. Don't use it. Because when you read about it, it is rich in fiber, it adds to bulk, it stimulates intestinal contraction, so on and on. But basically, it has to be consumed in large quantities. And it forms a big bulk in the GIT. So as such, when a patient is on morphine, as such, you know, the GIT is very sluggish. And then if you're going to give a bulk forming laxative like Isabgol, the patient will be very, very uncomfortable. So don't use bulk forming laxatives at all. Then comes osmotic agents. They'll draw water into the GIT and help in bowel evacuation. Again, that has no role in morphine-induced constipation. Morphine-induced constipation, the best is stimulant, next is softener. Or you can combine a softener and a stimulant. Now, you have seen paraplegic patients. Paraplegic patients need regular stimulants and stool softener, because you see, they don't have the power to force out the fecal matter. So you have to make the fecal matter soft and at the same time stimulate the GIT, because they're always bedridden, no movement. So the GIT also will be sluggish. But suppose a paraplegic comes to you and says, so many days since I've passed my moved my bubble. So first you should do a rectal examination and remove all the hardened fecal matter there. Then you might get patients with colostomies. They are also treated in the same manner as people not having colostomy, both same. So once they come with some problem, you have to exclude an obstruction. And then you can use the Bisacodyl suppository. But along with that, oral medication should also be given. Now, when you do the per-rectal examination, you find the stool is soft. Then you can use a Bisacodyl suppository. Suppose the stools are hard, better would be glycerin suppository. Sometimes when you do the rectal examination, you find an empty rectum, but the patient says he has not moved bowel for quite a few days. So what you can do is you can give enema and also start him on stimulant laxatives. Now, see, if a patient is constipated, what happens? The stools remain in the gut for a long time. And then as it remains there, more and more water gets absorbed. So the patient becomes very, very, very constipated. But after a few days, what happens? There are the gut bacteria. Okay, so they start acting on the fecal matter, and putrefaction sets in. Putrefaction means the stool will become liquid like. And what happens? The liquid stool will come on either side of the hard fecal matter and come out. So the carer or the patient will think he is having loose motion. But in fact, what is the problem? It is a spurious diarrhea, overflow diarrhea. So whenever a patient talks about diarrhea, the first question you should ask is, how many days since you moved your bowel satisfactorily? If he says 4 or 5 days, then you should think, okay, this is not diarrhea, this is spurious diarrhea. So what you should be doing is doing a per-rectal examination and looking at the nature of the fecal matter collected in the rectum. Okay, so when you do, suppose you find soft fecal matter, bisacodyl suppository. Hard fecal matter, bisacodyl or glycerin, both can be used. And as I told you, enema also for complete evacuation. But the PR, per-rectal examination, is the most important. You should do that, find out the nature of the fecal matter, remove the hard fecal matter, and then only give enema. So before, when you do a per-rectal examination, you should explain everything to the patient very well. And tell him, I'm going to insert my finger. You won't be having any pain because you see, I am lubricating my finger with local anesthetic. And then you let him lie down in the proper position and slowly you insert your finger. And at the same time, you should be watching the patient's face and preferably talking with the patient, because then the patient will become very relaxed. Otherwise, you know, patient will become very tense and, you know, the rectum will, I mean, have a firm grip on your finger and you will not be able to move your finger freely in the rectum. So that is about constipation. And now about intestinal obstruction. Okay. It is known as MBO, malignant bowel obstruction. It's a common complication of various advanced malignancies, especially CA carcinoma of pancreas, colon, rectum, and ovaries. The most common cause of obstruction is malignancy, but non-malignant conditions can also lead on to obstruction. Now, this obstruction can be either partial, total occlusion of the gut, or complete. It can be partial or complete. Partial occlusion or complete occlusion. Obstruction can be at one level or at multiple levels. So obstruction can be due to mechanical reason or functional reason. Functional means ileus, sluggishness. Okay. Site, it can occur at any site. And depending upon where the site of obstruction is, it can be considered as 4 different syndromes. Suppose the obstruction is at the level of esophagus, mainly at the gastroesophageal junction. Mainly it will be unable to take any food, vomiting. Okay. Or it can be at the proximal small bowel or distal small bowel. Or it can be at the level of large bowel. So depending upon where the obstruction has occurred, the signs and symptoms will also vary. Okay, I told you it is as a result of malignancy, but it can be due to non-malignancy also. One is, you see, as a result of the paraneoplastic neuropathy, the nerves are damaged. As a result of that, the intestine has lost its tone. It's very sluggish. Another is aerodynamic ileus. Ileus, you know, paralytic ileus. The entire thing, maybe due to drugs. Anyway, the result is that the intestines are sluggish. Patient is not moving the bowel, almost like an obstruction. Post-surgical adhesion. Patient has had a surgery and some adhesions have occurred. Intestinal dysfunction due to opioids or a coexistent inflammatory condition affecting the intestine. All these are not malignancy per se. That's what need not always be malignancy, but most common cause of obstruction is malignancy. Now, what happens in intestinal obstruction? Fluid and gas will get retained. Suppose here the obstruction is proximal to it. Proximal to it, fluid and gas will get retained. So naturally, the pressure in the intestine will increase. So this will lead on to all the neurons get activated. Okay, vasoactive intestinal peptides are secreted. That will lead on to increased fluid secretion in the intestine. So you see hypersecretion, and that will lead on to further increase in the intraluminal pressure. So you see, it starts as fluid and gas retention, intestinal pressure increases, vasoactive peptides, hypersecretion, again further secretion, again further increase in pressure. So it is a vicious cycle is set up. Now, if you are talking about the obstruction at the gastric level, it can be due to mechanical resistance. Maybe the patient is having a CA stomach or a CA pancreas or huge ascites or huge hepatomegaly. All this can cause a mechanical resistance so that the intestine is almost as if there is an obstruction there. Or it may be due to physiological, like, you know, gastroparesis, something like paralytic ileus occurring in the stomach. Now, if the obstruction is at the gastric level, no persistent nausea. Actually, the patient will feel much better after vomiting. After vomiting, he is comfortable. And vomitus is not bilious. It's not bilious. But there will be dyspeptic symptoms. What can we do? You should treat the underlying cause. Whatever is the underlying cause, you should treat. Okay. And, you know, suppose you find that the stomach is dilated. What you can do? Reduce the stimulus to the, and so the best thing to give is a prokinetic drug like metoclopramide. When you give metoclopramide, the stomach will again start contracting and the dilatation will become less. Okay. See, so whenever you try to manage, try to relieve the obstruction as far as possible, but more important is the symptom management. If the patient is having vomiting, that should be managed. If the patient is constipated, that should be managed. So managing the patient's symptoms is the most important. And investigations help, definitely. They can confirm the obstruction. They can confirm the level of obstruction. They can confirm the cause of obstruction. Okay, so medical and surgical options are available. I'll be coming to it. Now, coming to intestinal obstruction, most common in the bowel and ovarian cancers. Multiple sites are usually affected. Okay, plain X-ray abdomen helps us in telling us there is obstruction. And again, surgical option, medical option. Always you should be working on the quality of life of the patient while planning the treatment. Now, suppose the intestine is partially obstructed, not total. There's a tumor here and pressing on the intestine like this. So it is partial obstruction. So when you give steroids, steroids reduce the bowel edema. So the lumen becomes bigger. Okay, that is the role of steroids. And then again, you see, because it is compressed by the tumor, the intestines are all very sluggish. So you can give a metoclopramide, a prokinetic, so that the peristalsis is again, it gets started. Okay, sometimes, you know, it may be a complete obstruction. There also, you cannot do any surgery, but definitely you should try to relieve the patient's symptoms. I told you a lot of secretions are there. So you can give drugs to reduce intestinal secretion. The patient will be having nausea and vomiting. That also you can treat. Now, obstruction can be sometimes at the proximal intestine or at the distal intestine. Proximal intestine predominant features will be bilious vomiting, periumbilical pain. Okay, whereas distal obstruction, there will be mainly abdominal distension and constipation. Mainly. So you see, if bilious vomiting is the main problem, you know it is somewhere in the small intestine. Whereas if it is distal obstruction, it will be mainly constipation and abdominal distension. So if you take a plain x-ray of the abdomen, it's very simple, non-invasive, it will not cost much, then we can be sure, okay, there is an obstruction. But if you want to find out what is the cause of obstruction, then CT will help you. Otherwise, a plain x-ray is all that you need. Now how to manage? Our decision will be based upon the level of obstruction, the clinical stage of cancer, overall prognosis, presence of ascites, and the patient's performance status, how good he is. Okay. Poor surgical prognosis seen in advanced stage when there is ascites, palpable abdominal mass, previous radiotherapy, history of combination chemotherapy, multiple sites of obstruction, poor performance status of the patient. All these are associated with very poor prognosis. So what to do? Resting the gut for some days. Okay, resting. And that sometimes even it helps to relieve the partial obstruction. And don't stop oral completely. Just oral sips of fluids you should allow to keep the mouth moist and comfortable. At the same time, you can give fluids IV or subcutaneously. And don't put in an esophagogastric tube unless the patient is having large volume vomits, or if he is vomiting several times a day. Otherwise, don't put an esophagastric tube. And at the same time, you should be correcting all the electrolyte imbalances. Now, pharmacological treatment is steroids, analgesics, anti-emetics, anti-secretory drugs. So four groups of drugs, okay? So if pharmacological treatment is introduced early, it can definitely reduce the symptoms, and sometimes even partial obstruction will also be relieved and the patient's quality of life will improve. Now I told you steroids along with analgesics. Analgesics, two types of pain these people could be having. One is abdominal colic as a result of peristalsis, because there is a block. At the same time, the intestine is contracting, peristalsis. So he will be having colicky pain, or he will be having a persistent nociceptive pain due to tumor infiltrating the abdominal structures. Okay, so best is giving morphine, round the clock morphine, regular, 4 hours a day, or as a continuous subcutaneous infusion. Now, the pain can be colicky or non-colicky. If the patient is having colicky pain, that means there is a tight obstruction. So don't give prokinetics. You should never give. Then under that circumstance, you can give only hyoscine. If the pain is non-colicky and he is passing flatus and some motion, also nausea and vomiting. Because if he passes flatus, you know, he is not having total obstruction. In that case, you can give metoclopramide. So injection dexamethasone, whenever you would give it, you should combine it with injection ranitidine. Okay, injection dexamethasone is given to reduce the peritumor edema. And ranitidine is an antacid. Whenever you give Dexona, you should be giving an antacid. Also, ranitidine is very good for decreasing intestinal secretion. Okay. Anti-emetics. What are the anti-emetics? Metoclopramide, I told you, if he is not having colicky pain, if he is not having colicky pain only, you should be giving metoclopramide. You always start with 10 mg 8th hourly, 10 mg 6th hourly. Gradually you increase. Maximum you can go up to 120 milligram in 24 hours. Maximum. Okay. Next option is haloperidol. If the patient is having nausea, the best thing is to give a small dose of haloperidol. Now, you will all be interested to give ondansetron, because I told you mainly there are a lot of secretion. Okay, secretion. So bowel distension also occurs. Bowel distension is as a result of secretion of serotonin. So definitely you can give a serotonin antagonist like ondansetron. That also has a role. Then if the patient is having colicky pain means you cannot give metoclopramide. In that case, you should be giving either hyoscine bromide or hyoscine hydrobromide. Okay, these are the two things to be given if the patient is having pain, but if it is not colicky pain, this should never be combined with a prokinetic like metoclopramide. You should not be combining metoclopramide with hyoscine. Now, corticosteroids, the usual dose given is 16 mg. And if whenever you give high dose dexa, it should be given prior to 3 p.m. Because if you give it late at night, you know, it will induce euphoria and the patient will not be able to sleep comfortably. And whenever you give steroids, don't give it long periods. You give for 3 days and then see if the peritumor edema is decreasing, if the partial obstruction is relieving, if the patient is better. In that case, you can. Otherwise, you know, 3 days trial. If there is no improvement in 3 days, don't stop it. Then somatostatin analogs. Because I told you the main problem is hypersecretion. Lots of secretions in the GIT. So octreotide is very good. It reduces the hypertension, because such a lot of secretion, the pressure inside the gut is also very high. So when you give octreotide, it will relieve the partial obstruction. Okay. And mainly these patients, you know, they develop a vicious cycle. Distension, secretion. Distension, secretion. So when you give octreotide, it's really helpful because it improves water and sodium absorption from the gut. So secretion into the gut is also less. Okay. And what about proton pump inhibitors and histamine H2? Definitely, they have an action on the gastric parietal cell. Okay. They will reduce the gastric secretion. And in this respect, actually, histamine antagonists are much better than PPI, because histamine antagonists are better than PPI in reducing the gastric secretions. So medical management in a nutshell, dexamethasone 3 days trial, metoclopramide or hyoscine. If he is having colicky pain, hyoscine. Not colicky pain, metoclopramide. If he is having nausea, haloperidol. And if you want the, definitely octreotide can be given, but it is very, very costly. Very, very costly. What about palliative surgical options? Okay, you can do a resection, stoma formation, endoscopic stent placement. These are, you can go for selected patients only. Okay, suppose the patient is having gastric outlet obstruction, definitely you can go for a gastric venting via a PEG. Okay, percutaneous endoscopic gastrostomy. Then nowadays people are also using self-expanding metallic stents. But I mean, surgical, when should we go for surgical options? Mainly those having single obstruction who show good response to chemotherapy without ascites, without extensive metastasis, relatively young patients with good performance status. In such condition, corrective surgical options should be done. And again, when bowel obstruction is as a result of benign causes like band or postoperative adhesions, then also you can resort to corrective surgical options. So you just look at this. Look at this woman, okay, with a nasogastric tube. You see, she looks so sad, depressed. Okay, and look at this woman. Same condition, but no tube and sips of water the nurse is giving. So you yourself imagine which position would you prefer? And that's what you should be preferring in your patient also. Okay. So thank you very, very much. Exactly 40 minutes. If you have any doubts, you can ask me.
Thank you so much, ma'am. We have heard about both constipation and bowel obstruction. Madam has talked to us about how to assess constipation. How does the patient comes to you? What would be the chief complaints? And how to do examination, especially perirectal examination, which is very, very important. And how to differentiate the findings. Very important topic, overflow diarrhea. Patient complains with loose stools, so we try to manage the loose stools. So how can it aggravate to another constipation? So overflow diarrhea is a very important topic. And how to choose, what are the classification of laxatives and how to choose appropriate selection of laxatives. It's not about just giving any laxative of our choice, but it is about how the constipation and choosing appropriate laxatives. Then we heard about bowel obstruction, how to do assessment in bowel obstruction, what would be the complaints that patients will be coming with, especially when it is partial or distal, how would it be partial obstruction and what are the symptoms when it comes to distal obstruction. Then we heard about various drugs and management strategies, how to treat palliatively the partial or complete obstruction, various drugs including their dosages and how to switch between the drugs when we think that it is complete, not partial. And a palliative surgical options for selected patients especially, and how to choose wisely between the drugs. So there are a few questions in the chat. The first question was about morphine-induced constipation. How would you manage morphine-induced constipation?
Whenever you start a patient on morphine, you have to give laxative. And the ideal laxative is a stimulant laxative like bisacodyl. It should be given as long as the patient is on morphine. The patient should continue to take bisacodyl. Some patients respond with 10 mg HS. Others may require 20 mg HS. So you have to titrate the dose depending upon his, depending upon how often he is able to satisfactorily move his bubble.
There are many people asking, what if there is an absolute constipation with morphine? Should we stop morphine?
What is the meaning of absolute constipation? Absolute constipation means he has not moved his bubble. So when a patient comes like that, usually the patient will be coming with history of loose motion. And that is a spurious diarrhea, which I told you about. So you have to ask one question. When was the last satisfactory bowel movement? From that, you will know it's actually constipation. So you talk to the patient, make him lie down properly, do a proper per-rectal examination. You will find that the rectum loaded with hard fecal matter. Then you have to gently remove the hard fecal matter and then give an enema and also start the patient on regular oral laxatives. You should never ever stop morphine. The patient has developed constipation because you have not given him laxative. That is the reason. You should never stop morphine. You should do whatever is needed to correct the constipation.
Madam, should we decrease the dose of morphine is another question.
No, definitely not. Morphine, you tighter the dose to suit his pain level. So he is on that level. Don't think about morphine. The problem is with you. You are not giving him laxatives. So you think of increasing the dose of laxatives or see that he is on the right laxative. Don't ever think of decreasing the dose of morphine.
So then, if it is not morphine-induced constipation, whether bulk forming laxative is an option,
It's not at all an option, especially in paraplegia. Paraplegics are always lying bedridden mostly. So their intestines will also be sluggish. So they need a stimulant laxative. And again, you know, because they are all sedentary, their fecal matter will be quite hard. So what they need is a softener. So you can give a combination of a softener and a stimulant. Never ever give bulk forming. Never ever.
And is there any point in reducing the fiber in the food if the constipation is due to morphine? Should we reduce the fiber content?
No. You should increase the fiber content. Why should you decrease the... Because increasing the fiber content will actually lead to better bowel movement. So
target
this...
bowel...
Target bowel.
Is there any target bowel a day if we use morphine? I think what should be the adequate bowel opening that we are expecting? I think that is what the question means.
Yeah, that depends upon the patient's habit. Some people, you know, they move their bowel daily. Some people, they move their bowel twice a day. Some people move their bowel on alternate days. So it all depends upon the natural lifestyle of the patient. The thing is that he should not be passing hard fecal matter. He should be able to move soft bowels.
What about if patient is already on 20 milligram HS dose of bisacodyl and still constipated? Should we add another laxative or what should be done?
If he is on, you should find out the cause of constipation. If he is constipated as a result of morphine, you can definitely add a stool softener like docusate or liquid paraffin. On the other hand, maybe he is in a hospital setting and he wants his own toilet. In that case, you should take steps to discharge him home. Or maybe he's not getting privacy. So you arrange for privacy in the setting. Or he's not drinking adequate water. So let him drink plenty of water. So whatever be that reason, you have to look into the reason for the constipation. I told you most 90% it is drugs. But other conditions are also possible. Any other?
Any other question? So far, over from the chat, but is there any other question regarding bowel obstruction? Because that is a really important topic and the management, you need to be thorough with the management to differentiate between partial or complete, distal or proximal. So is there any question from bowel obstruction?
I know Shridevi, maybe they have not understood about MBO. Is that the reason?
It was very clear. The slides were really clear. So there is one question. Can it be clinically differentiated? Dr. Geetika, you mean the partial or complete obstruction clinically differentiated? Or I did not understand.
If you take a proper history, these patients come with symptoms like nausea, vomiting, constipation. That will be the triad of symptoms. And again, you see, if it is more of bilious vomiting, that is upper intestinal obstruction. If it is more of constipation and abdominal distension, it is a distal bowel obstruction. So that is the level that you know. Then simple questions you can ask. Are you passing flatus? If the patient is passing flatus, then there is no complete obstruction. It is a partial obstruction only. So a proper history itself will help you a lot. And then I told you a simple plain X-ray abdomen will help, will tell you, okay, there is intestinal obstruction. And then ask the patient, are you having pain? Is it colicky pain or non-colicky pain? Colicky pain means it could be a total obstruction. Non-colicky and the patient is passing flatus. That means it is a partial obstruction. That is the way. So that medical management is steroids with analgesics with anti-emetics. Okay, steroids you give, then anti-emetic. Anti-emetic, if it is non-colicky, you give metoclopramide. If it is colicky, you give hyoscine. And then if there is nausea, you have to add in the haloperidol. And if the patient, still you find the patient is symptomatic and they are rich enough, then definitely octreotide is very good. It decreases the secretion so much. So the distension will become much less. The intestinal pressure will become much less. So the patient will feel much comfortable. What is this? For reduce edema in bowel obstruction.
For reducing the edema in bowel obstruction, should we use?
No, we use dexamethasone. Dexamethasone is the one which is universally being used. So we don't use methylpred. We use only dexamethasone. Any other?
Any role of NG tube in complete obstruction?
I told you, I showed you a picture also. As far as possible, don't insert a nasogastric tube in palliative care setting. Give them sips of fluid. That will make them... but sometimes, you know, patients come with fecal vomitus, then of course you have to put in a nasogastric tube and aspiration.
So just to share the experience, we had one patient who had a nasogastric tube for venting basically, but he wanted to have food through mouth. So when he tastes everything through his mouth, and when the stomach is distended, he will drain the fluid out. So he could eat whatever he wanted for the remaining few days, but the tube was in place and he knew how to manage. Whenever he feel distended, he will take it out, but he will eat through the mouth whatever he wanted in small quantities.
That is our policy in IPM also. If at all we put in a Ryle's tube, continuous Ryle's tube aspiration, whenever the patient asks for something to eat, we give it. Even recently, when I took rounds, one patient, Tadayo, I even remember his name. He asked for an omelet. We gave it. But just two or three mouthfuls he took. He was very happy. And the next day he asked for chicken biryani. That also we allowed. That again, one or two mouthful. But a week later he died. His entire family was happy that if we were elsewhere, then nobody would have allowed us to give him what he wanted. Because we are here, he can eat whatever he wants. So he was so happy. He loves chicken biryani like that and all, they were telling. So it is quite possible. Any other?
Yeah, there is a question on how should we ask about constipation, because many of them don't feel that constipation is a big problem for them. So how to ask exactly?
Actually, you are telling constipation is not a big problem. That means you have not actually communicated with the patient, especially if the patient is elderly. They are so bothered about their constipation. It is the carers who are not bothered about the patient's constipation. Because you see, when you start going for home care, you will find one thing. All the medicines will be regularly given to the patient except laxatives. The carers will not give laxatives. That's the thing. So patients are always bothered about constipation. It is the carers who are not bothered about constipation. So what you should ask is, when was it that you moved your bowel satisfactorily to your satisfaction? If the patient says today morning, well, he's happy, leave it there. So he's just as pain is best explained or expressed by the patient, so also the adequacy and the satisfaction related to bowel movement.
So Dr. Geetika is mentioning that it is a taboo regarding discussing about constipation. They may not ask you, but they even go to the counter and take the medications, but they may not ask. Doctor.
Yeah, that means they are bothered about their constipation. Only thing, they may not be getting the ideal laxative. Mostly if they go to this OTCs, you know, the pharmacist will give them Isabgol because that is very costly. And all the pharmacists love to give that. So that is the worst laxative one could possibly have. So, I mean, so many things are taboo. That is why you are in palliative care. You have had a session on communication. So you know how to break that resistance from the patient's side. That is your ability that you should cultivate.
And I think it would be the common response from the patient the moment you ask about constipation, they or their caregivers will jump and tell you he's not eating. So it is okay. Even the patient thinks that I'm not eating, so it is okay to have. So it's very important to tell them it is not at all related to what they are eating or drinking. Madam, would you like?
Yeah. Again, you know, whenever we do a perirectal examination, I always make it a point to allow the carer inside, because the carers only insist, oh, he has not had anything for past 2 weeks. How can, then why do you want to give him an enema? So we always get the patient, all care also to be with the patient. My God, and the amount of fecal matter which comes out, you will be terribly surprised to see. Yeah. The carers also. Once the carer sees that, you know, then this mistake will not occur on the part of the carer.
Any last questions or comments from your side before the presentation?
Yeah, constipation is a very, very common symptom. And mostly what the patient will be telling you, suppose you ask him, you tell me what exactly is your problem. He will say, oh, I have problem from head to foot. I have pain all over the body. I don't feel all right. Then you can make it very certain he is having constipation. Yeah, that's the way they answer. I have problems from head to foot. I'm not at all well. I have problems all over my body. That is constipation.
And madam, I would like you to share your experience with patient presenting with confusion and relieved by relieving constipation. Elderly patients coming with
confusion. Is it confusion actually? Sometimes even they can present with hiccups, you see, persistent hiccups. That is because the entire GIT is dilated, including the stomach, and continuous hiccups, you know. And when you ask, when did you move your bowel? 1 week back. Yeah. And then you do a perirectal examination. given enema, and like 2 to 3 kilograms of fecal matter even come out. After that, you know, slowly the hiccups also come down. The confusion I have not actually seen. I don't think I have seen confusion.
We do get patients, elderly patients with delirium, and very commonly the sole reason might be constipation, and yeah, they don't accept the.
Yeah, there delirium
was a question, regarding that thing. There are no other questions. We can move on to today's case presentation. So today, Dr. Priya. Yes, yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. In the inpatient ward or even in the outpatient clinics, we tell them to ensure bowel opening once in 3 days at least. That is the minimum. Either if they are not passing for 2 days, either doing a peritoneal examination or suppository. Even at home, we tell them if the patient is not opening bowel for 2 days, keep a suppository. And we train the caregivers to give the suppository or an enema at home also, because it's not possible to go to home every time to manage constipation. So it's important to train the caregivers to assess and manage constipation at home also. So today's presentation was supposed to be done by Dr. Priya. She had an unavoidable emergency and she couldn't attend or log on to the session. So I will be reading through the presentation and then we will discuss on whatever questions she has, and we will pass on to the learning points to everyone, and she also will get the same. So I don't know anything about this case, but she sent this details. So I'll be reading it. So the patient is a 64-year-old male with diagnosis bowel obstruction, CA sigmoid colon, and Hardman procedure done. Next slide. So there was intermittent abdominal pain for 1 month, 2 weeks of constipation, 2 days of abdominal pain and vomiting. Next slide. The patient has history of diffuse abdominal pain for last 1 month. He used to apply hot water bags over abdomen whenever he gets the pain. Occasionally, he takes analgesics from local medical shops. There was associated alteration in bowel habits, especially constipated stools, and he also describes one history of doubtful blood in stools. His wife also has noticed loss of weight and loss of appetite for past 1 month. The constipation was disturbing and he took laxatives as advised by the nearby medical store. 2 days back, he started vomiting around 6 episodes, which was bilious and foul smelling. He had associated severe abdominal pain and was brought to hospital in a dehydrated state. Next slide. Emaciated patient, he was dehydrated with Ryle's tube draining fecal matter, pallor was there, abdominal distension, bilateral pedal edema, guarding and rigidity of abdomen on examination. Significant investigation, HB was 7.8, ESR was 42, platelet was okay, sodium is 128, potassium 3.1, and X-ray abdomen, dilated bowel loops with multiple air fluid levels. Next. Treatment and significant, so in terms of treatment, I think they have correction of dehydration with IV fluids, correction of anemia with 1 pint of PRC. Since all blood parameters were normal, the patient was taken for emergency laparotomy. Intraoperatively, fecal peritoneal contamination and a very large mass seen at sigmoid colon, which was seen perforated. Liver showed nodular lesions. Hartmann's procedure was done, which involved resection of the rectosigmoid colon with closure of rectal stump and formation of a end colostomy. Next slide. Psychological aspect, stress management with regard to procedure, especially a big wound left out with abdominal drains, adaptation to the colostomy bag, adaptation with Ryle's tube feet, fear of impending death. anxiety regarding how the family will react, as he was the sole breadwinner of the family. Marriage of their single daughter, which is planned in the next 6 months. Financial difficulties with respect to further treatment and care. Next. Medications, IV antibiotics, epidural ropivacaine, probably for pain, I guess. Injection tramadol, 50 milligram IV, 12th hourly. Injection clexane, SCD for DVT prophylaxis, care of drains, Ryle's tube and colostomy. Next. The wife and daughter were worried on coming to know about his illness and told the doctor not to disclose it fully, as it may concern his situation with regard to his spiritual and psychological aspects. They were very worried how they would manage his hospital expenses and also whether the marriage would happen as they come to know about this illness. They were very anxious regarding that there should not be any suffering with pain for him. Next. So this is a 64-year-old patient, complains of pain abdomen, altered bowel habits, foul-smelling vomitus, dehydrated, and was taken for emergency laparotomy, diagnosed as intestinal obstruction at level of sigmoid colon with perforation. Palliative hemicolectomy and end colostomy was done. Next. So how well can you provide palliative care? How good communication help understand the family members regarding the seriousness of illness and care of patient? How well can we communicate with the future in-laws? So these are the discussion points sent by her. I think as we have heard a lot about bowel obstruction today, we should discuss a little bit about how in this situation we should manage the bowel obstruction palliatively. If this kind of patient is coming to you with all these symptoms, for this patient there is an emergency laparotomy, but if all these symptoms come to you, how do you manage? We'll discuss that also. Raju, the last the discussion points, can you the questions? Yes. I think everyone knows that it is a great stigma, especially with the colostomy bag. When he goes back home and the marriage is fixed in next 6 months, how hard it would be for the family to convince even the family members walking around with a colostomy bag. So let's ask the participants, how do they feel to overcome these issues? How to communicate? And the family members have told that not to communicate anything about the illness to the patient. So how to go about it? You have learned about it in the communication sessions, but I would like to hear from you. How do you manage that?
I think all of them are asleep. They are all asleep, I think. Are they all sleeping?
No, there are comments coming up. So I think at least some people are awake. The family needs to be spoken to and asked to voice out their concerns. So their concerns are mostly about the marriage and the financial expenses. So there should be awareness regarding colostomy bag and colostomy care. And tell them that this is a life-saving process. So there is a response to your question, ma'am. We are not asleep. They are not at all. So at least someone can unmute and talk so that at least third voice can be heard other than madam's and mine. Dr. Mohit has said listening is the key to learning. Is it about the session or about the patient? Sorry.
Ma'am, even the discussion, when there's nothing much to be incorporated in, when you're getting the best of a discussion to be heard, I feel just to get into for the sake of making a statement, I don't think would contribute from anyone. That's my opinion. Until unless if there is something more that can be added, yes, it should be welcome all the time. So point was that, because ma'am felt in the last session also that you were sleeping. It wasn't that. And this session also, ma'am thought you were sleeping. It's not like that.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Mohit. I was confused whether it is about the patient or about the session. So there is a suggestion, do a family meeting, what exactly they want for the patient. Ask to family members what exactly they want, ask the patient exactly. Yes, ma'am. So family's trust needs to be gained slowly, and we could try and convince them to tell the patient about the condition. And I don't know how you must be encountering a lot of patients like this with a colostomy bag. It's a great stigma in terms of living in a house, cleaning the colostomy bag, and then sometimes even with the religious rites. So we had a patient telling that just because that he had a colostomy bag, he is unable to. He was working in a temple. So then he was very distressed, very much distressed. He was having all kinds of symptoms of depression. And then I talked to him about an hour. Then this came out that I'm working in a temple. I could not. And that was something helping me to cope with everything. Now I am unable to go to temple because there is a fecal matter inside my bag and I'm carrying it around all the time. So I asked him, like, you can clean it and it is okay. Anyway, you are wearing clothes and going. But he's like, I'm feeling unclean, impure. So I cannot go. So a lot of spiritual and psychological issues come along with a colostomy bag. And many a times, patients won't even anticipate a colostomy bag. They are taken in for a surgery. Maybe intraoperatively, they would find that he needs a colostomy bag. And patient comes out, opens the eyes and see a bag with fecal matter hanging outside the tummy. So that is really, really distressing for the patients. And here, I think they told the family members about the procedure. That's what I understand from the presentation. Any experience from your side in terms of managing colostomy bag in distress? And how did you manage, how did you go about it? Yeah, we do see concerns about colostomy bag, but with training and counseling, they usually accommodate. And for females, very commonly, they are not allowed to cook in the kitchen just because you can imagine you have a fecal matter bag. So many of the in-laws won't allow them to cook in the kitchen. So we had to have a family meeting several times talking about it. And there is a colostomy irrigation training available so that they can have a good control over the colostomy bowel opening also. They cannot hide it for a long time from the patient. Have a family meeting and counsel them regarding prognosis and treatment. Give psychosocial support to him. Exactly. So it's better to start the communication. You might have heard this, heard about this in the communication sessions a lot. It's very good to start with the delusion or collusion right from the beginning. Otherwise, it will become more and more difficult to get a rapport with the patient later on. You have to tell everything one fine day. So it's better to start as early as possible regarding communicating the prognosis. Madam, we were discussing mostly about how to communicate with the colostomy bag, coping with the colostomy bag, stigma around the colostomy bag.
And
madam, would you like to talk a little bit about the irrigation? That's what I was about to say.
The main problem with the stigma with colostomy bag is with regard to, always the bag will be containing fecal matter and which nobody will like. So you see, this is the best time to talk about irrigation and, to start on it. How soon after, the kind of nursing issues, is it over? 3-day classes for them?
No, not over.
Illa. Okay. Yeah, you can wait for sometime, say after 2 or 3 months, you can start the patient on irrigation. And once the patient is started on irrigation, just at one time in the morning, at a fixed time, he will be able to move his bowel. And the rest of the time, he has to have his colostomy bag, but that will not hopefully contain any fecal matter. So that is a stigma regarding colostomy bag. It can be removed by a proper session regarding explaining to them about irrigation. And secondly, I think definitely a session is needed with the in-laws. And you know, you don't know, because it appears that it is a metastasized sigmoid carcinoma. That is what it says, with carcinoma peritoneal carcinomatosis. So we don't know. So we can even suggest, you know, preponing the marriage. Preponing the marriage is also a possibility. And that same Tadev I was talking to you about, who wanted omelette and chicken biryani, his son's marriage was fixed 2 months later. But we took an active role, and his son's marriage happened 7 days after he was discharged from IPM. It happened on a Thursday, and the next Saturday he died. He attended the son's wedding. He went to the church, sat, and from the church he called me. Madam, I am in the church attending to my son's wedding. So things are possible, you know. So if you actually ask the patient, he might say, I'm not bothered about the illness. After all, I have lived for 64 years. I want to see my daughter married. If that is so, you can take steps to even see that the marriage is preponed. Anything else?
So how well can we communicate with the in-laws? So patient, we can convince a patient. So how do we communicate in our society that this patient has cancer and the prognosis is bad, and especially colon? So how to
communicate? Yeah. I think Kerala, it will not be a problem. But rest of India, I'm not very sure. But Kerala, I don't think you will have any problem, because you know, mostly the conditions here are quite different from what's happening elsewhere. So even when you call them and talk to them, I think they will understand, you know, rather than they getting any fancy ideas regarding CA colon. If they know it from the treating doctor, that this is the situation and this is what can be done, and how they should, and seeking their cooperation, that will be, I think that will make them very important, and they will feel very happy about it, I feel.
So there was one sentence mentioned in the slide that he has a fear of death. So how do we speak to a patient about fear of death? That is one question in the chat.
Yeah, fear of death. You know, again, when you say fear of death, you say mainly the fear is regarding the dying and not about death. Death and dying are different. Dying is the process, active, the process wherein he is dying, where death is something which has occurred. So if you talk to such patients, they will be bothered about the dying process. How will it be? Will I be having pain? Will my wife be with me? Will my children be with me? So those are the worries which are. So if you are able to talk to them and get these things solved, you know, then they will be much more comfortable. We often mistake between death and dying. Both are different. So he may be frightened about the process of death, that is dying. But you explain to him that, you know, he can have a peaceful, painless, dignified death, and that should make him satisfied.
So there is an experience shared by Dr. Karpagavalli. The patient family should be counseled and made to understand that it's not the end of the world, because doctor's father had surgery for CA rectum. And initially I told him it's a temporary colostomy, but later after 3 to 4 months, I told him it's permanent. I did the entire colostomy care for him and made him understand that it's not a big thing. Now it's almost 1.5 years and he travels and is very confident. He does his own colostomy care, like changing bags, cleaning, etc. Even though the cost, cost of colostomy materials is quite high, and government doesn't pay even for poor patient. So initially, her dad refused to enter the puja room or temple. But later, when I explained, made him understand if the bag is clean, he is more better than the normal people, where we have our fecal matter inside our body. Yeah, true. So I feel it's all about talking and making the patients and his family members understand. Thank you so much for sharing such a personal experience with this group, Dr. Karpagavalli.
Is he on irrigation? Yeah. Is he doing irrigation? Is your father doing irrigation?
Yes, ma'am. He cleans the bag by himself, actually. He's not on irrigation.
And if he's on irrigation, the condition will be much better. Yeah.
He's not on irrigation, but there is a nurse coming once a week to change the entire set of colostomy. But he does his own bag change and cleans the bag.
Now, when you undergo this course, you will learn about irrigation. And the next thing, you should empower your father regarding irrigation also. That will make his condition much better.
Okay, sure. Definitely. Thank you very much.
Cost is another thing people are really worried about. The cost of colostomy bag and stuff. So that is one thing, everyone. But as madam told, when you start practicing the irrigation, mostly that cost is covered when you have a regular routine bowel habit. The cost of bag is not a problem anymore. Any other question, even from the session today, about constipation or bowel obstruction?
Ma'am, you just mentioned about irrigation. Can you just enlighten us more about this? I've actually never heard of irrigation in colostomy.
Yeah. I think, Sridevi, they will be having nursing issues class.
Yeah, madam, but we don't cover irrigation in detail. So if you can just mention a few words, even from your experience, how it changes patient's life. Then.
Yeah, but that, you know, I don't think they will understand without the diagram. You see, irrigation, if you practice, irrigation, normally we all move our bowel only once. But with colostomy patients, you know, always the bag will be containing fecal matter. That is the problem. So irrigation is a process by which, you know, this patient goes to the toilet, sits on the toilet seat, and there is a bag of water, tap water, and, you know, the other end of the tube. So the there is an IV fluid set there. The other end of the tube goes into the colostomy site. The colostomy, that site, you know, it goes inside. And this water is allowed to run in. So this water from the bag above runs into the intestine. And it remains there. And then, you know, after some time, what happens? This tubing is closed. And this, because he's in the toilet, and there is an irrigation bag also, a long sleeve. And that is connected to the colostomy site, and the other end goes into the toilet. So you see, all the water which has run into the intestine will come out. And then in that, the entire fecal matter will also come out. So initially, you have to do it 14 days regularly at the same time. Suppose you decide to do it at 7 a.m., you do it at 7 a.m. on 14 days. 14 days are required for the body to develop a reflex that at seven o'clock is the time when the bowel movement should occur. Then after that, daily at 7 a.m., this fellow goes to the toilet and does this thing. So, you know, the entire 24 hours contents will come out. So practically for the rest of the time, the colostomy bag will be empty, practically empty. Though you have to have a colostomy bag. I mean, you have to see it, you know, otherwise I don't think you will understand when I am talking about it.
How does this running of water take place, ma'am? How does the running of the water take place? Is it a set which makes the water to go?
It is coming from a bottle. Bottle is suspended ulta. And you know, an IV fluid. And that IV set is there. A tube. So other end, After 14 days, it should be done daily at 7 a.m. The first 14 days in the importance is that, you know, the body needs 14 to 21 days for it to attain a reflex, to know, because the body will not get any message. So if you do it at the right time and the right time for 14 to 21 days, the body will know. Now it is the time for me to move the bowel. So he has to do it daily at the same time. So morning itself, the entire fecal matter will go out. And rest of the time, the bag is there, but the bag will not be containing any fecal matter.
Thank you so much, ma'am. That was really insightful. Now further, everything, I think I'll follow it up with the YouTube presentations. Thank you so
patient
much.
Patient will be in sitting position, ma'am.
Yes, he will be sitting on the toilet seat.
Okay.
Yeah, usually, you know what happens in certain poor homes, there will be only one toilet. And in the morning time, everybody will be busy going to the toilet. So even that we have to consider. So we have to ask them, what time will you get? Because the entire irrigation will take about 1 to 1.5 hours. So till that time, he should not be disturbed. So you should choose a time which is suitable for him, and he will get about 1.5 hours to himself. Otherwise, it will not work.
Thank you very much.
And one question, how frequently are the colostomy bags changed? Is it after irrigation? Like is it for someone who is doing irrigation, or you are asking generally? There is a question.
What is it? You don't have to change the bag after irrigation. We do irrigation with another long sleeve bag, not this one. It has a long sleeve. The upper end comes on the colostomy side and the other end is in the toilet, you know, so that, you know, when the fluid comes out, the entire contents will go into the toilet.
So she's asking generally how frequently the colostomy bags are changed.
That depends upon the quality of the bags you buy. Then there are disposable and non-disposable bags. And again, how carefully you use it. All these are important matters.
And are these irrigation bags single use?
No, not at all. They can be reused. They are washed and they are hung in the sunlight and dried.
Any other questions? Madam, just you have mentioned, but still usually we see a lot of hydration methods when patient is having bowel obstruction. People, when they stop eating and drinking, they tend to hydrate, including total parenteral nutrition are being given, which is a very common scenario that we see. So what is your say in that?
We in IPM, we don't give total parenteral. We don't. It is so costly. And again, you know, they buy such a costly thing, and inevitably they land up with some rigor and we are unable to continue it, which make them very sad. So we give only IV fluids if IV line is available, or we give subcutaneous route.
Thank you. I thought someone will ask. If no one asked, so that's why I brought that into question. Because very commonly when you get a consultation for bowel obstruction from the department, you see a TPN hanging on, and then we need to communicate to them how it is not important to give all these expensive things, because they put all their hope into the TPN bags. So it's really important to start communicating why this obstruction is happening and what is the irrelevance of these kind of interventions.
Ma'am,
I told you, no, sometimes we can even go for surgery. And I gave you the indications also. Single level, young patient, no ascites, no metastasis, good performance status. All this, we can even think about a proper curative surgery. But here we are talking about a patient in the palliative care setting who already has a primary malignancy and who has come to you with an intestinal obstruction. So you know the condition, especially if he has a gross ascites, multiple site obstruction, and he is emaciated, and you know the prognosis is not very good. So there's no point in making them spend a large amount of money.
Ma'am, may I just ask, how do you give it subcutaneously? You said you give hydration subcutaneously, no?
Yeah, we give subcutaneously. I mean, it cannot be told like this, you know. Are the nursing issues like a parallel?
Yes, they will. Okay. Yeah,
you come to that. Okay. Yeah.
And you must be seeing all, a lot of subcutaneous thing in everyone's presentation, like medications, mm-hmm. hydration. So that is a very common yeah. route of administration of most common of the medications thing. In palliative care. So we'll be covering that during nursing issues. So if there are any last question, we can or we can wind up the session for today. Thank you so much, ma'am, once again for today's availability and presentation and your sharing your experience in terms of colostomy irrigation and everything, because that is something really new that we all need to learn. Thank you so much, everyone, for your interaction through the chat, and for Dr. Priya for bringing up the patient's story. Although she could not attend the session, we'll be sending you all the learning materials and